good friend. He will tell us about density matrix RGE. Originally, he was supposed to talk about time-dependent RGE, but based on requests from various friends, he will go into the details, nuts and bolts of TMR.
So thank you very much, Bhaskaran, and also thanks to all the organizing committee, namely Shankar, Mishra, and many others who have been responsible for this meeting and who have invited me to present this talk. I am going to go through very basic DMRG method because Bhaskaran and Vijay asked me about it sometime back, and then they said you can cover the time dependent RG tomorrow. Day after tomorrow, am I right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, well, what are the kinds of Hamiltonians that we basically work with? Let me go through first. If you look at the tight binding Hamiltonian, this is the tight binding Hamiltonian. Supposing I introduce electron-electron interactions between the orbitals over which these creation and annihilation operators are defined, then I will have a full Hamiltonian, which is the tight binding Hamiltonian plus the interaction part. IJKL are the two electron integrals. I have written them in a slightly unusual form, which is actually the chemist's way of writing the two electron integrals, which is density-density repulsions. So electron 1 is in the charge cloud, overlap charge cloud of orbitals I and J. Electron 2 is in the overlap charge cloud of K and L, and then there is an interaction between them. But of course, this Hamiltonian is also very difficult to deal with. So people in chemistry made what was called the zero differential overlap approximation. In this approximation, they said that because you are looking at an overlap charge cloud of two orbitals here and two orbitals here, and because you are only dealing with one side, one orbital per side, that is, there is only one orbital on side I and one orbital on side J, then unless you know the electron 1 is sitting in the charge density at a given particular site and the electron 2 is on another side, the electron repulsion integral is zero. So in other words, IJKL is nothing but IJKL delta IJ delta KL. If you do this, and then you also, of course, physicists went one step further and they said that the interactions are screened out by the electrons in metals, because metals have very short Debye-Vickers screening length, and because of the short Debye-Vickers screening length, electrons will feel repulsion only when they sit on the same side, and otherwise they won't feel any repulsion. So they said that we will throw out all the integrals IIJJ for I not equal to J, and then you get your Hubbard model. And of course, in the large limit of the Hubbard model, you get your Heisenberg, spin-off Heisenberg model, and so forth. And chemists, of course, always deal with semiconductors, organic semiconductors, which are organic polymers. So they don't want to throw out all these UIJ, IIJJ terms. Instead, they parameterized the repulsion integrals, which are this one. Which are these integrals IIJJ, instead of throwing it out, they parameterized it using what are called two different kinds of parameterizations. One is called the Ono parameterization, and the other is the Matagawa-Nishimoto parameterization. This is the one that is used widely, and so you get the Padzer-Parr-Popel Hamiltonian, which is actually a Hubbard model plus intersite density-density interactions. And you also introduce a local chemical potential so that the site is neutral when it has got zero number of electrons. Well, this is still a one parameter model because you see that if I have all carbon atoms, then U's are all same for all the sites, and so VRIJ is parameterized in terms of U's and the distances, and so this is still what the Padzer-Parr-Popel model is, still a one parameter model. So this is the model Hamiltonian, which is you have the U term, you have the T term between two orbitals, which is a transfer term, then the U term, which is on-site repulsion, and then the V12, the V13, and so forth. And this is the Padzer-Parr-Popel Hamiltonian, which was introduced in 1953. Well, if one wants to do exact diagonalization methods, Sukhvinder already told us that you are going to be having a d to the power n kind of a problem. That is, if you are dealing with fermions, then the Fock space scales as 4 raised to the power n, where n is the number of sites. if you are dealing with spins, spin off objects, then it goes as 2 to the power n, where n is the number of sides. So even though the models conserve the total S and MS, the Hilbert space of these models is extremely large. Okay, and even when you use total spin conservation for a 14 side problem, the number of singlets is 2.76 million. And then you go to a 16 side, 16 electron problem, the number of singlets is like 34.7 million. So it's actually extremely difficult to do these calculations for very long systems. So I think the present day limit would be probably 18 sites, 18 electron system with all symmetries possible. Then probably you can, breaking your back, you can do the calculations. So ED methods are really not good for systems where you cannot do the extrapolations. See, usually what people do in these exact diagonalization techniques is that they calculate the energy per site, or they calculate the optical gap or whatever, and then try to extrapolate it as a function of, inverse function of the chain length, and then extract the thermodynamic limit information. But if you are looking at polymers like, which are called polyparaffinylene vinylenes, which has got 8 sites per unit cell, then you can only do the extrapolation over 2 unit cells, and it doesn't make any sense. So that is the reason why you cannot do these calculations using the exact diagonalization methods, and polyene problem has been beaten to death, which is actually 2 carbon atoms per unit cell. So you can actually do the calculations for about 8 to 9 unit cells and get extrapolated data which are reliable. But you cannot do that for real polymers which are important in organic electronics. So that is the reason why you have to go for other kinds of methods, and ED methods provide excellent check on approximate methods. So they are not useless, because you can always fall back on the exact diagonalization methods and see how good your calculations are, approximations are. Well, approximate methods are many. In the chemistry literature, one of the most used approximation method is what's called the restricted CI method. So you have got the Hartree-Fock Slater determinant, which is a starting point, and then you create particle hole excitations around this. So if you create a single particle hole excitation, you call it singlet configuration interaction. You can create 2 particle hole excitations and 3 particle hole and so forth. So people do SDCI methods. The problem with SDCI methods or restricted CI methods is that it is not size extensive. So because it is not size extensive, you cannot do extrapolation of quantities to the thermodynamic limit. Then there are other size extensive methods like coupled cluster methods, which have not been widely used in the context of these model Hamiltonians, and also they are quite complicated to use. So that's why it's not become very popular, but still in the nowadays you do see coupled cluster methods actually bundled into various kinds of quantum chemistry packages. Then you have the quantum Monte Carlo methods. Quantum Monte Carlo methods for fermions, particularly if you are going into higher dimensions or longer range interaction, longer range transfers, and if you are also away from half filling, you have got all these sign problems, and because of that you cannot do the quantum Monte Carlo methods. And even with quantum Monte Carlo methods, getting information about excited states is very difficult, because if you want to do that, then there are tricks, but again pretty expensive and difficult. So then you have the renormalization group methods, which are the energy eigen. There are 2 kinds of renormalization group methods: the numerical RG method, which was based on the energy eigenvalues, and the other one is the density matrix eigenvalue based methods. So this is something that Miles spoke about in the morning. So supposing you want to do a renormalization group method, supposing I take a 2 boxes of length L by 2, and from the eigenstates of the 2 boxes of length L by 2, I want to construct the eigenstate, the ground state eigenstate of the box of length L. You see that if I have 2 eigenstates like this, then there is no way I can get rid of the node at this point, so I will never converge onto this one, but actually I will converge to the first excited state. So that is the reason why you cannot do an energy based methods, and this has proved being actually in quantum systems. People tried it, Chui and Bray tried it in the late 70s or early 80s for spin chains, and then it turned out to be giving you very bad errors, errors of about 5% for the this in ground state energy per site for the spin half Heisenberg model. So that's the reason why you cannot do these kinds of things. But on the other hand, you want to do density matrix based methods. Well, density matrix based methods are not new to chemistry, because one of the things that the chemists used to do was take the one particle density matrix and get the eigenstates of the one particle density matrix. The one particle density matrix eigenstates are called natural orbitals. So you keep all those natural orbitals which have large density, and then construct your Slater determinants around these natural orbitals, and then do a configuration interaction calculation, in which case you would get a large part of the correlation energy is regained in your calculation. So density matrix method was quite well known, but it was not tied to, yeah.
In the first place, how do they get the density matrix?
You see, you start with a Hartree fork, and then do a, you know, either a Myhler-Plessett perturbation theory or CI, you get your eigenstate. From the eigenstate, get the one particle density matrix, and then use the one particle, natural orbitals to rewrite your Slater orbitals, and then keep continuing. Okay, so iterate. Of course, this does not have the RG component. The way density matrix renormalization group method is different from this natural orbital basis is in two very important ways. One, you are not looking at just one particle density matrices, but many particle density matrices. And you use the eigenstates of many body density matrices to span the Fock space of your system block. And then the second one is that you also keep augmenting the system as in the RG approach. So you keep adding either two sides or one side or three sides, depending upon the kind of problem you are working with each time, so that you augment the system. But when you augment the system, you want to construct your Hamiltonian matrix, which is of the same dimension as before. Only the Hamiltonian matrix elements are different. So you are renormalizing the Hamiltonian in that sense. The coupling constants are changing constantly as you keep increasing the size of the system, but the size of the Hamiltonian matrix or the size of the Hilbert space that is spanned is not going to be increasing. So this is what the density matrix renormalization group method is. And now let me go over to the implementation of the density matrix renormalization group method for the simplest case of a spin-half chain. So in the spin-half chain, you have, let's start with the four-side problem. Okay, I have four spin-halves and I have taken open boundary conditions so that my Hamiltonian is S1 dot S2, S2 dot S2 prime, S2 prime dot S1 prime. The prime sides are always on the right side of the block and the unprimed sides are on the left side of the block. And if you look at the left block has the states, Fock space states, which are these four states corresponding to two downspins, two upspins, spin one down, spin two up, spin one up and spin two down. So these are the four states you have. Now, for the use this Hamiltonian and construct a, so if you have four spins, you basically have the basis states are actually the direct product states of the left side Fock states and the right side Fock states. So you basically have a 16 dimensional Fock space. So in this 16 dimensional Fock space, you can write down your Hamiltonian matrix. That's quite simple because each one, you know, S1 dot S2 can be expressed as S1 Z S2 Z plus 1 half S1 plus S2 minus plus S1 minus S2 plus. So you know how to operate by these things on these spins, and so you can pick up the coefficients. Once you pick up the coefficients, you get the Hamiltonian matrix. Once you get the Hamiltonian matrix, you can get the ground state. And the ground state can actually be written as sum over the left block states and the right block states times a coefficient C, which depends upon the left and the right block states, times a direct product of the left state and the right state Fock space states. Okay, so this is very easy. So basically, this will have, like, if I am looking at MS equal to 0 state, then it could have up down times down up or up up times down down with a certain coefficient here. So the eigenstate is very easy to obtain. So it's only a 16 by 16 matrix. If you specialize it to the case of MS equal to 0, it will be a 6 by 6 matrix, and solving a 6 by 6 matrix is extremely trivial. So once you get this, what you do is you construct the density matrix for the left block, okay, rho LL prime. So what is rho LL prime is sum of the right block states CLR CL prime R. So you know these coefficients CL, CLR, and so from the CLR and CL prime R you can construct rho LL prime. So this is actually a 4 by 4 matrix because L and L prime are actually, L belongs to a Hilbert space of dimension 4. Now you can diagonalize the density matrix. So you obtain eigenvalue mu lambda and the ket vector mu lambda as the eigenstates. Now what you do is, now let me jump to something that is more than four states, because four states is too small. So assume that you had actually done this calculation for a fairly long enough chain, that you had something like 256 or 512 is the dimension of the left side space, because if it is 256, it means that you are working with a 16 side chain, and then you have the density matrix for the 8 side chain. So you will have something like 256 density matrix eigenvectors if you want to deal with a larger problem. And now what you have to do is you want to construct a renormalization matrix OL which truncates based on from the 256 dimensional space to, let us say, 128 dimensional space, which means you only keep 128 dominant eigenvectors of the density matrix. So you order your density matrix eigenvalues in a decreasing order, keep the first 128, and the first 128, the eigenvectors corresponding to the first 128 eigenvalues is what will be used in the construction of the renormalization matrix OL, and these are all nothing but the column vectors. Mu1 is the column vector which is 256 elements are there. Mu2 is another 256 element, and mu 128 is also having 256 elements in a column. So basically this OL matrix is a L by N matrix. If L in our case was 256 and N in our case was 128, then you see that this is actually 256 by 128 matrix. So you can depict this also for the right block, okay? And of course I was telling somebody that block diagonalizing, diagonalizing this matrix, the density matrix rho, is a very, very easy job, simply because rho can be written in a block diagonal form corresponding to different MS values. So usually even if it is 256 by 256 matrix, it is block diagonal corresponding to MS is equal to 4 all the way to MS is equal to minus 4. So there are 9 blocks. Each of these blocks is small enough that you can actually obtain the eigen vectors and the eigenvalues quite easily without resorting to any of the more advanced techniques for actually obtaining the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, or doing the singular value decomposition like Sukhvinder was talking about.
So in this case, repeating for the right block would
be
very different.
It won't be. If you have a symmetry, then you can actually use the same thing.
Your Hamiltonian has symmetry.
Depends, you know. The correct Hamiltonian has a symmetry, but the, you know, in general it may not have the symmetry. Okay. But because depends, if you are having hetero atoms in a chain like polymethanamines, carbon nitrogen, you will not have symmetry. So you repeat this for the right block as well, and once you get the density matrix, then you can write down your Hamiltonian matrix corresponding to the left block. So for the left block, the Hamiltonian matrix is just a 256 by 256 matrix, or in the simple case that I took, it is just a 4 by 4 matrix. Okay, so supposing L equal to 4 and M equal to 2, which is very bad approximation. So you will have a 4 by 4 matrix and you have kept only 2 vectors for in the density matrix, in the renormalization matrix, so that OL will be a 2 by 4 matrix, HL will be a 4 by 4 matrix, OL dagger is a 4 by 2 matrix. So when you do this transformation, HL gets renormalized to HL tilde, which is actually a 2 by 2 matrix. So it's simple matrix multiplication. So all you need to do is you have a non-square matrix O, which is of the which is a M by L matrix, and M by L matrix, and then you have your Hamiltonian for the left block, which is a L by L matrix, and M by L by L by L by H, L by M matrix will be the M by M matrix that you will get. So it's very simple to do this, and so this is the renormalization. So you can also renormalize all the other kinds of matrices. For example, for the site 1, I want to find out what the matrix S1Z is. So S1Z matrix for the site 1 will be a diagonal matrix, and because it is up is the first state, the first diagonal entry will be half, and down for the second one, the second diagonal entry will be 0, minus half, third one will be plus half, minus half, like that. So you can very easily write down this matrix for the SZ. So once you write down the matrix for SZ, you can also renormalize the SZ matrix. So you have to renormalize all the necessary matrices for calculating a Hamiltonian matrix element at the next stage. Okay, so this is how you renormalize it, and then you repeat the process for the right block. So now what you have got is a renormalized or a truncated Hamiltonian for the left block, and truncated matrices for the operators of occurring on the left side, which are interesting to you. Like you can have the operator for S plus, you can have the operator for SZ, you can have corresponding to sites 1 and 2. So you will have 4 operators in this particular case that you will have to carry through. So now I will augment the system. And how do I augment the system? I add two new sites in the middle. So I call them 3 and 3 prime. So now the left side, earlier the sites 1 and 2 were actually spanned. The Fox space was spanned by the four states up, up, down, down, up, down, and down, up. Now it is going to be spanned by only probably two density matrix eigenvectors, no more the four states. So it's only the two density matrix eigenvectors. So this block is only a 2 by 2 block for the Hamiltonian. So if I write down the Hamiltonian of the augmented system, then this is the Hamiltonian of the left block, the Hamiltonian of the right block, interaction between the two new spins, S3 dot S3 prime, interaction between the spin at site 2 of the left block with the new spin on the right, on the left, and then the new spin on the right is interacting with the second spin on the right block. So this is HL plus HR plus S3 dot S3 prime plus S2 dot S3 plus S3 prime dot S2 prime. So this is the Hamiltonian. Now what I have to do is obtain the Hamiltonian matrix. Now to get the Hamiltonian matrix, I use a mixed basis. The mixed basis that I am going to use is the density matrix eigenvectors of the left block, which I call mu, and then the Fox space states, which is either the spin is up or down for the sigma 3, and then I have the sigma 3 prime, which is again up or down, and the two density matrix eigenvectors on the right, which I call mu prime. So I have a mu, sigma 3 prime, and mu prime, and the dimensionality of the space is, this is 2 into 2, 4 into 2, 8 into 2, 16. So it looks like just a 4 spin system, because the dimensionality of the space is not changed, it is still 2 to the power 4. I started with 2 to the power 4, I am ending with 2 to the power 4. And now I have to write down the Hamiltonian matrix. So I need to write down the Hamiltonian matrix in this basis. The basis is density matrix eigenvector on the left, which I call mu. The density matrix eigenvector on the right, which I call mu prime. Sigma 3 is the density matrix, is the Fox space state for spin 3, and sigma 3 prime is the Fox space state for spin 3 prime. So this is the matrix element I have to calculate. And this matrix element has lots of Kronecker deltas simply because of the orthogonalities. So you have mu h tilde l, mu. So this is the matrix that we have already calculated, and this appears only for delta sigma 3, tau 3 are the same, sigma 3 prime, tau 3 prime are the same, mu prime and mu prime are the same. Similarly, you can write down for the right, and then you come to the mixed terms, for example, like sigma 3 times sigma 3 dot S3 prime, then you have the matrix representation of S3 in the space of up-down spins, and then S3 prime you have in the space of sigma 3 prime, tau 3 prime, so you can write down this. And for this one, you have it in the mu nu basis and sigma 3, tau 3 basis. So you can just, it's a matter of writing down several direct products of matrices. So it's simple direct product of matrices, and you can get your Hamiltonian matrix. Once you get the Hamiltonian matrix, what you do is obtain the ground state. And once you get the ground state, go back and do this particular thing. So when you do this, you get the density matrix now not in terms of rho L and L prime, but rho L sigma 3, rho L prime tau 3. Okay, so that is the basis in which I will get the density matrix eigenvector, because the left part now is actually a combination of the old density matrix of the two side problem multiplied direct product into the spin states of the new spin. So this is actually the one that gives you L will be actually mu times sigma 3, and L prime will be mu times tau 3. Okay, so this is the one that actually gives you this three arms for your tensor. One is mu, the other is nu, and the third one is actually sigma 3. Okay, so it's actually the three arms correspond to one of the raw spin and the other two are the density matrices, matrix eigenvectors. So I will come to that one later on, but that's how you will get the equivalent of the tensor. So now what you do is obtain the desired eigenstate of the augmented system. New left and right density matrices of a new eigenstate, new renormalized left and right block matrices. Okay, the Hamiltonian, the spin states, everything you can renormalize and obtain the new renormalized matrices. And once you have got all these renormalized matrices, you are ready to add two more sites. So you can go to the 8-site problem. The 8-site problem again has the same dimensionality. So the dimensionality of the matrix will always be 4m squared, because I am dealing with a spin half problem and I am adding two sides at a time, and the dimensionality of the number of density matrix eigenvectors I have retained is m. Okay, so it is a m by this thing, the density matrix eigenvectors are m in number, and the Hilbert space of the Hamiltonian is 4m squared.
Two phase.
Yeah.
So first is what you are saying is and what Miles mentioned this morning, and trying to connect to. So he was saying that the eigenvalues of the density matrix, they'll be falling in some way, and you need to make sure that they fall fast enough so that within two or three they're essentially zero. So if you keep eight or four, whatever is your favorite number, you may miss out on some of the higher eigenvalues.
Correct. So that's the reason why you have to do calculations for different cutoffs. Okay, so usually when you do a cutoff calculation, CGS calculation, you do calculation for different cutoffs and then find out which is a satisfactory cutoff, beyond which either the neglected density is very small, or if you have some exact calculations to compare against, then all your energies are within the error bars that you are happy with. Okay, so usually one keeps cutoffs of nowadays 1,000 is not very uncommon. Okay, n of 1,000.
Second.
Yeah, please.
So you took two pieces like this. This was a free and this was a free. I mean, nothing on the other side. You added two sides here. So instead of to neglect or to get rid of these end effects, why don't you think of a geometry like this? Add one here and one here.
Yeah, that's what I have done for cyclic boundary conditions. It works very well. This is something that we did because we were working with molecules, particularly having six-member rings and all that. And in order to build it up, we had to go through a different algorithm. And at that time, we discovered that if you do a cyclic boundary condition, it's always better to think of it as two leg ladders joined at the ends, and then you keep adding two new sides. Okay, and that's something that I'll talk about. For cyclic boundary conditions, that's the best way of going about it, because otherwise, it is error prone. Now, calculation of properties is another important thing. So once you get your desired eigenstate, and within that particular eigenstate you want to calculate all the properties, the kind of properties that you are interested in are spin densities at various sites, if you are dealing with radicals, or charge densities, because if you are dealing with a carbon nitrogen chain, you want to know, or the donor acceptor chains, you want to know how much of the charge has been transferred. For example, TTFTC NQ system, if you want to model, and then you want to know how much of the TTF has donated how much electron into the TCNQ, that kind of things that you will need to know. So for that, you will have to calculate these expectation values, which are quite straightforward. This is something that I think, I don't know whether it was Supinder or Miles, they talked about. Basically, it is nothing but the matrix representation SIZ, I think you spoke about it. So all you do is you have your matrix representation of the SIZ operator on the mu basis, and the expectation value is nothing but C mu sigma sigma prime mu prime, C mu sigma sigma prime mu prime, so that it is actually a summation over all the states, but making use of the fact that you have the canonical deltas between the states on the left and the right. Okay, and the Bra side and the Ketch side, the sigma and the sigma prime must be the same as tau and the tau prime. And mu prime must be the same on both sides. So only matrix that comes in is this one. So it's quite easy to calculate these kinds of quantities. Now you can also calculate correlation functions. Okay. Now calculating correlation functions, one has to be careful, because if the two operators that you are dealing with are on different blocks, then it's very easy to calculate. You don't lose the accuracy. So if they are on different blocks, like one of them is in the left block and the other one is in the right block, I shall put J prime here. I made a mistake. So SIZ, SJ prime Z is what I'm looking at. Then you know that you can again calculate it in the usual way. Just simple, straightforward, the elementary quantum mechanics. You can get the expectation value of this one. But if the two side operators are on the same side of the chain, this is error prone. This is not good. So what you need to do is, whenever this happens, so for example, many a times you will have to calculate things like bond order. So bond order is the AI dagger AI plus 1, plus the Hermitian conjugate, that is the Bondorf operator. So if you want to calculate the Bondorf operator, then this is a very bad way of going about. So for doing that, what you would do is, the first time that this pair occurs, SIZ, SJZ occurs on the left side, you construct the matrix for the product. And you keep renormalizing the matrix, the product matrix every time. So you deal with it as if it is a single matrix and then keep renormalizing it, and then you calculate the expectation value. So this is very important, because if you want to calculate correlation functions, if you do a brute force correlation function calculation where even for the same block you have taken just the product of the matrices SIZ and the matrix SJZ and then try to contract it, then you will be having large errors. So in order to avoid the errors, you will have to actually do this renormalization of the product matrix. And this renormalization of the product matrix is the one that actually creates a lot of problems, particularly when you want to calculate correlation functions and obtain structure factors and so forth. Now, all the while I was talking about targeting the ground state. So how do you get the excited states? So of course, there are very trivial ways of getting excited states. One of them is that you can get the ground state in the ms equal to 0 sector and the lowest energy state in the ms equal to 1 sector. The gap is going to be most probably the gap corresponding to the spin excitation. Okay? But you would not know the spin of the excited state, because neither would you know the spin of the ground state, because you only know the ms values. Okay? So, yeah.
Before you go to excited state, is it possible to make some connection with what Miles was talking this morning in terms of his operations? Or yeah. Even Lewis was making?
Yeah, yeah. These are the contractions I was talking about. So,
because
okay, let me go to the simplest case. And I'm sure Sukhvinder will be able to throw some light on that. So this is the operator that he had put in the middle between the two blocks, okay? And then he contracted it, okay? So this is nothing but the contraction of your operator with your matrix product states. So a matrix product state is this one, okay? And I'll tell you why that is a matrix product state as we go along. But this is exactly the this is figures in which you had a red dot coming in the middle, and then you have these blue circles on top and all that, and then you try to contract it. Okay, so that is exactly what I am doing here. Yeah.
But they have basically to have the entire package that it brings.
Yeah, but that entire information is in this one.
Yeah, but then you have the product of all.
So this is already contracted. This is already contracted.
I see. So if I want some information, some correlation function between this side and the one that I have.
On the other side. So that's right. So you have the. So that's what I'm trying to say. So you have.
Right.
You have one matrix on the left, one matrix on the right. So you are contracting one matrix from the left side, which involves mu and nu, and another one on the right side, which involves mu prime and nu prime. Okay, so it just that you put two dots on the two different sides, which again he showed. So and he was contracting it, and then and the whole entire information about his matrix product states is buried in here. Okay, this is actually after contracting the matrix product states. Is what you would get these coefficients. If you want
all
to.
The product of all the, in Miles' language.
Yeah, in Miles' language, all 1, 2, 3 up to all the left block times the mu 1 of the sigma and the sigma prime, and then the product of all the matrices on the right block. Okay? And all, that is what gives you these coefficients.
So these coefficients also depend on how many times you have done it.
That I am going to talk about. The finite DMRG procedure is different from the infinite DMRG procedure.
What you are doing is?
Infinite DMRG procedure, which is actually more like a toy DMRG. Okay, so it's basically a toy DMRG, and then we'll go to the finite DMRG procedure. Okay, let me see how we can target the excited states. So if you want the first excited state psi 1, then what we do is right from the beginning we construct the density matrices corresponding to from the psi 1 instead of from psi g or psi 0, and we can go through the entire calculation. So that way we can get the psi, the excited state psi 1 within the ms equal to 0 sector. Of course, if you want the excited state, the lowest excited state is in the ms equal to 1 sector, it's trivial to get it, because you get the lowest state in the ms equal to 0 and the ms equal to 1 sectors, the difference in energy will give you the spin gap. Okay, so supposing the supposing it is not the spin gap, see, because what happens is many a times in molecules the lowest excited state can be is a triplet state, and the second excited state is a second is a singlet state. So often you want to get the gap between the lowest state and the second singlet state. Okay, so you have to get various different kinds of gaps. I'll come to that one in a while. So you can do this psi 1, but if you want to simultaneously target psi 0 and psi 1, even that is possible. All you need to do is you take an average density matrix. So wi is the weight and rho I is the density matrix corresponding to the state psi I, and then you construct the average density matrix as I equal to 0 to p, where p are the states you are targeting, p plus 1 are the states you are targeting. So you can actually obtain the density matrix eigenvectors and assume that these density matrix eigenvectors span in a balanced way all the states from ground state 0 to the peak excited state. Okay, so it's a hope. It may not be realized, but it's a hope, and you can do that. Initially, when Steve White came up with the idea of cyclic boundary conditions, he said the best way of implementing it is put one site here and the new site at the other end, so that you are basically having an interaction which is long bound interaction, if you want to call, only between the state n prime and 1 and state between state n prime and 1. So this will be the longest range interaction, and you will have interaction between n minus 1 and n, and n and n minus 1, and 1 prime and n. Okay, so sorry, there will be an interaction between 1 prime and n, and then n prime and 1. So these are the long ones, because the ones that are, so you can keep constructing your cyclic boundary condition by adding these kinds of sites in this fashion. But the problem is that these kinds of interactions that you introduce are extremely error prone, because if you look at the density matrix corresponding to the operator matrices of the operators corresponding to site 1 prime, it will have undergone many times renormalization. Okay, so you start with 4 sites, to go to the 6 sites you have renormalized it once, to go to 8 sites you would have renormalized it twice, to go to 10 sites you would have renormalized it thrice, and so forth. So if you go to say 200 sites, you have already renormalized it almost 100 times, and then this interaction between 1 prime and n prime will be extremely error prone, and that is the reason why this method does not work very well. But on the other hand, if you introduce this method where I said that you start with a ladder, I have all the left side odd sides are on top and right side odd sides are on bottom, and then I keep introducing sites in the middle, then the longest interactions you have is 5-7 interactions. That's always 2 sides removed. So if the interactions are only 2 sides removed, it's highly accurate. And using this, you can get the spin gap for the spin-half Heisenberg system going to 0, because spin-half uniform Heisenberg model must have 0 spin gap. And that 0 spin gap you get correct to about 10 to the minus 5, which is pretty good. So you do a finite system DMRG whenever you are interested in obtaining the eigenstates of a finite system of 2n sites. So whenever you are constructing a 2n site system, what's happened is at every stage you have not used the density matrix corresponding to the 2n site system. For example, the density matrix corresponding to 3 sites, rho 3 is from the 6 site system, rho 4 is from an 8 site system, rho 20 is from a 10 site, rho 10 is from a 20 site system, and so forth. So in the 2n site, in order to construct, what you really want is that all these density matrices are actually density matrices of the 2n site system. So you want the rho 3 to be the density matrix of the 200 site system, or rho 4 also to be of the 200 site system, and so forth, not of the 8 site system. So if you want to do that, then you will have to do what is called the finite system DMRG. and this really improves the energies enormously. So I'll just show you how one goes about this one. So what you do is, you do your infinite system DMRG and you come to a stage where you have N2 minus 1 sides on the left, N2 minus 1 sides on the right, and then two sides sigma 1, sigma 1 prime in the middle. So you have the total is 2 N sides, N2 minus 1 plus N2 minus 1 plus 2 will be 2 N sides. So you have an N side system. The density matrix of this one is actually rho L N by 2 minus 1 and that one is rho R N by 2 minus 1. Now what you do is, you construct the density matrix corresponding to N side problem, which is incorporate this into the left block and then get the rho N by 2 on the left. Use the old rho N by 2 minus 2 of the right and then you put two new sides to the right and then you have an N side system. Right? So now you do the calculation of this one and get the density matrix for the rho N by 2 minus 2, which is the first iteration density matrix, because you replace the old density matrix that you had for N by 2 minus 2 by the one that you get from here. And you keep doing this, it's almost like a zipper. So it keeps going to the right until you hit only one side on the right and then you get the new matrix O1 R prime, and then now you zip it back until you come to one side on the left and then go back again until you have equal number of sides on N2 minus 1 and N2 minus 1 on the left and the right. The density matrices now that you have are actually the first iteration density matrix, not the zeroth iteration density matrix. And these density matrices are more accurate than the density matrices I started with, which are here. So because of that, when I do the calculation of the ground state energy, or the energies and the eigenvalues, they are much more accurate in this particular case. So that's how you do your finite system DMRG.
So why is it more accurate? Why is it more accurate?
The more accurate is because, see, what I said was, for example, when I had this density matrix at the first iteration, it was the density matrix of N by 2 minus 2 system, not of a 2N side system, but of a 2N minus 2 side system. Okay? But you really want the density matrix to be of the 2N side system. Okay? In order to make it more accurate. So initially you started with density matrices of smaller systems and not density matrices, small density matrices corresponding to large systems.
Okay, so this is the way, in this way of doing it, your first row is some guess of the...
Correct. That is the one that he was talking about. Psi 0, which was a guess. And then you go to psi 1. So that is exactly what he was talking about, that going the DMRG space from psi 0 to psi 1 to psi 2 and so forth. That nice picture that he had was actually exactly this one.
So I guess that means you will run this simulation in the inference system up to some level.
Up to some level.
And then you will come and do this
zipping back and forth until you are satisfied. Usually it doesn't take more than 2-3 iterations to converge. And then you say, okay, now I have reasonable numbers. So I can live with it.
So in contrast, directly writing the matrix products, then optimizing those matrix elements.
But that is...
That's the end result.
But that is murderously hard. Because supposing I am looking at matrices which are like 200 by 200 matrices, M equal to 200. Then how do I optimize all the 200 matrix elements of all the 200 sites?
But suppose I assume translation matrix. I have essentially one matrix. Would it be helpful?
Your translation invariance implies that you are having a cyclic boundary condition.
For example. Yeah.
Okay, for example. Then maybe it will be helpful, but even then you will have 4,000 parameters. 40,000 rather, 200 by 200. So assume all the symmetries and all that, you still will have a large number of parameters. Am I right, Sukhin? Okay. So that is one of the problems. So I think my own take on matrix product state is that it is that DMRG is the best way of actually getting the matrix product state functions. Okay, so it's just matrix product states were known for a very long time. I think even the DMRG in some form was known. Baxter had done it in statistical mechanics using the Karnan matrix, this renormalization group. If you go to Toshino's website, the Kobe University, so you will see Baxter had done it in 60s. Okay, so but that was you know, actually going from a this thing, treating the two-dimensional classical model as a one-dimensional quantum model. Transfer matrix technique. Okay, so I had done that. So, but the point is that is a density matrix renormalization group is the one that actually gives you a handle on how to do things.
So there is some nice matrix.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody was asking if you can display one such n result in terms of the form of the matrix, optimized for a reasonable chain. How does it look like in terms of?
It looks crazy. No, it is not in any tri-diagonal form, nothing. In fact, if you want to get the eigenvalue, you may actually cast it into tri-diagonal form using a Lanczos scheme, but that is not greatly accurate. It is better to use a Davidson scheme. So it is not, if you look at the matrix elements, it's messy, but it is sparse. The matrix is reasonably sparse, so we use the sparse matrix techniques. Okay, because of so many Kronecker deltas, the matrix is really sparse. So you don't have to work with all the zero matrix elements. It is sparse simply because of so many Kronecker deltas that come in the actual matrix element.
So which is related to
rotation. Okay, it is also true even in other. Even in other models.
No, just following up the process of, you said the final result is a matrix, right?
Yeah.
So, okay, but one can also...
Hamiltonian matrix.
That's right, but one can also say it's the ground state wave function, right? Because if I had this n, then if I go to the, if I add these two particles, I am going to diagonalize. I'm going to get the ground state.
Yeah, yeah. You get the ground state, no doubt. But what I'm trying to say is that to get the ground state, finally you have to get the Hamiltonian matrix. This whole, the entire exercise of renormalization group is to get the Hamiltonian matrix, and with the Hamiltonian matrix elements as coupling constants which are getting renormalized as you keep augmenting the size of the system.
Right. So for example, the result has to be displayed. Could actually display some
eigenstate.
Some eigenstate.
Yeah, but that eigenstate will also be crazy. It's difficult to decipher right from. So that is the reason why you calculate all your correlation functions, expectation values, because eigenstate means nothing to you.
Suppose I take only a reasonable and then use a good matrix product which I have obtained by DMR.
Yeah.
What will be the typical bond dimension which will give me good results?
What is the bond dimension means?
Of the matrix. So you have the matrix.
Okay, for the Heisenberg system, the final truncation M, if you keep 32, then you get ground state energy per site accurate to at least a part per million. See, because the ground state energy per site is what? ln2 minus 1/4. Right? So that you get correct to something
so part. 32 weighted
to
sparse matrix.
No, m is 32.
Yeah.
So 32 squared times 4. That is the size. But then you specialize it to a Hilbert space saying m is equal to 0. So you can't a priori say what will be the dimension of the Hamiltonian matrix. You have to actually construct it. Okay? Because each of these density matrix eigenvectors have a ms value. Okay? Because that is conserved for the density matrix. So that you can work with a definite MS sector, MS equal to 0, let us say. So MS equal to 0 means that it will not be 4 times 32 squared, the size of the matrix, but it will be far less than that. So it will be less than 1000 by 1000. Yeah. No, in this one it is, I'm doing an asymmetric division in between, but then if I want to say I have completed one iteration, then I have to go from there to there.
Yeah, what is being in between? Can you start from there? Because anywhere.
What is the advantage?
You are visiting both sides, right?
Yeah, I'm visiting both sides, but what is the advantage is starting from an arbitrary division? That is starting with six sides. It could be equivalent, but the way people implement it is always equal sides because it's easy. You can use a reflection symmetry. And you don't have to calculate the density matrices for the left and right, at least in the infinite DMRG separately. See, in the infinite DMRG, if you have unequal number of sides on the left and right, then you will have to consider the density matrix for the left as well as for the right. Whereas, if you have equal division, then you can just use the one on the left onto the right. Okay, so that cuts down the calculation, numerical effort. That's for the infinite part. Afterwards, of course, when you do the finite sweeps, you have to have unequal ones. But to, in order to reach this one, you will require, usually, the size of the system is at least about 200 sites. Yeah, it's fairly large. So, just to recap the density matrix renormalization group technique, involves iteratively building a large system starting from a small system. Eigenstates of superblock consisting of system and surroundings is used to build density matrix of the system. Dominant eigenstates, about 100 to 1000 of the density matrix, are used to span the Fock space of the system. Superblock size is increased by adding two new sites, very accurate for one and quasi one dimensional systems such as Hubbard, Heisenberg, spin chains and polymers. So it's about 20 years back that Steve White introduced this technique. You can do that away from half filling also. Yeah. See, we have usually when you want to get the charge gap of a system, then no, not that. You go to 1 electron more than half filling, 1 electron less than half filling to get the charge gap. So that you know how the charge gap is going to extrapolate and is the system going to be a conducting system or a insulating system. You can do that. I think so, but I have not done that, so I don't know how accurate it is. But definitely, if you have a half filling plus minus 1 electrons or plus minus 2 electrons, even, it's still accurate. 15% doping, I don't know.
No, that's not exactly the same question. So, if I have 15% doping, so then how will I construct the states?
You'll have to construct 15% doping in different ways. That is, initially, you know. Oh, sometimes you add 1 electron, sometimes you add 2 electrons. The number of electrons that you add into the system, as you keep increasing the number of sites, need not be equal to the number of sites. Okay? So, and there are different paths by which you can construct, and you have to find out which is the best path.
Or introduce chemical potential and tune it as a parameter. But then the equal space is much bigger.
Okay, because then you are going to work with the Fock space. Yeah. So, but what we do is usually, you know, you have to, it's a trial and error method because you have to find out whether you are going to add 2 sites and 3 electrons or 2 sites and 1 electron or something of that kind. So it's a matter of, you keep adjusting it because we do come across that kind of things in some cases. Now I want to make explicit connection between DMRG and matrix product states. Okay, so let us assume that we did the finite DMRG. And then we went into the limit case where I have n minus 1 sites in the left block and only one site, which is the nth site on the right block. Okay, and my eigenstate psi is written in terms of the eigenvectors of the n minus 1 block times the Fock space state sigma n of the nth site. So it is mu n minus 1 sigma n, right? It's just straightforward because the states on n minus 1 is spanned by mu n minus 1. And the state on the nth site is spanned by sigma m. So, and it's a direct product of these two is what I have to take, and I get a representation of this one. Now, if you look at nu n minus 1, that can be written in terms of the density matrix eigenvectors of, these are density matrix eigenvector of a block with n minus 1 sites. So, the density matrix eigenvector of a block with n minus 1 sites can be written as a density matrix in terms of density matrix eigenvectors of the n minus 2 block and one spin at n minus 1 site. So this matrix gives me the nu n minus 1 in terms of nu n minus 2 and sigma n minus 1. Right? So I can keep doing this. So I can just substitute it back in this one and so on and so forth. So when I keep doing it, then what I'll get is psi will be sum of nu n minus 2, nu n minus 1, sigma n minus 1, sigma n, a n minus 1, nu n minus 1, sigma n, and all that. So this is just a matter of getting the products. So all that I have done is each one of these states that I started with nu n minus 1 can be expressed in terms of nu n minus 2 minus sigma n minus 1. Nu n minus 2 can be expressed in terms of nu of n minus 3 times sigma n minus 2. And if I keep doing that all the way, then the whole thing will turn out to be just the expression in terms of this sigma 1 sigma 2 sigma n nu 1 nu 2 nu n minus 1. So I will have a1 nu 1 sigma 1 nu 2 nu 1 sigma 2 nu n minus 1 sigma n sigma 1 sigma 2 sigma n. Okay. So what I am going to do is I will say that the contracting index that I have I will put in the on the horizontal arm, and then the spin index that I have I will put on the vertical arm, and then I will just multiply them out. So this becomes a matrix product state.
And in your approach it's not a variation because you get exact numbers for A's.
Yeah, exact numbers for A's. Yeah. So that is the connection between matrix product states and the density matrix renormalization group calculations. So it's just a matter of going back and forth. Okay?
But your point is that you can start with this matrix product answer, yeah, and then treating it as a variational problem is going to be very hard.
I think so. I think he should be able to. I am not very familiar with matrix product states per se because I have not followed it so closely. Okay, but the point is that I find you know after a while you stop developing things and start using things and it becomes a habit. Yeah, but the point is that both of them suffer from the same problem. See, if you are trying to, is basically the entanglement entropy problem. Okay, if the entanglement entropy is not a constant, then your M, that is a density matrix cutoff that you are going to keep, cannot be a constant. It has to keep increasing the system size. Because M, the DMRG cutoff, goes as e to the power S, where S is the entropy of the entanglement entropy. And entanglement entropy is a constant only in one-dimensional system because when you cut it, you only have two dangling bonds. But of course, near criticality, you have got logarithmic corrections like he was mentioning. And so you again have problems. But nonetheless, if you keep large enough M, you can go close enough to the criticality.
Sorry,
yeah.
Suppose I am trying to solve the ground state problem. Yeah. Then this, formally, this, all these A's will be identical.
Yeah, they should be, no?
So how will you see it in your analysis? Does it even stop there in one step?
I don't know. I mean, like, because I have never put my DMRG wave function that I got back into the matrix product states and looked at the matrices. So because I have to do it backwards, huh? Like what?
That's what you are.
Yeah. So I have not done that, so I don't know exactly how the matrices will look, but he must be having an idea in that. They are the same. So, but whether I will get the same, I may be getting the same, no, correct to some numerical accuracy.
No, but I thought the process
by
making them same a priori.
Even then you have a large number of parameters. Because if you are dealing with the 200 by 200, 200 is the cutoff that you have used for density matrix archive that you use, then you are going to be having 40,000 parameters. So there must be some systematic way of actually changing them.
So some of your symmetries, do they also get reflected in these
things? Should get reflected, but because when we calculate properties, the properties reflect that, which means the wave function does have that. We also impose the symmetries, but I'll talk about it a little bit later. I impose the symmetries. So basically, this is what I was talking about. If you are looking at entanglement entropy, then this is the entanglement entropy. If you have the density matrix rho L, you have the eigenvalues mu alpha, then this is the entanglement entropy. And this area law says that area between system and then this thing. Says that the entropy increases with the area between the system and the environment. okay, and the DMRG cutoff depends upon, exponentially depends upon the entropy, and because the entropy keeps increasing with the area between the system and the surroundings, you will find that in two dimensional systems is difficult, two and three dimensional systems is difficult to do a DMRG with constant M, but on the other hand in the one dimensional system the area between the system and the surroundings is exactly one side or two sides, whatever it is. So because of that the entropy is always a constant and it works, okay. And in fact we also showed the question is DMRG, if you have longer range interactions in DMRG, that is long range transfers, then long range transfers are equivalent to higher dimensionality. So your DMRG should not work. But in the Palliser power focal model, the transfer terms are not long range, but the interaction terms are long range. And the interactions are only diagonal interactions, interactions between charge densities and charge densities on two different sides. So in that case, we have found that DMRG works, you know, but we wanted to know why DMRG works even in the case of a Palliser power focal model. And for that, we calculated the entanglement entropy for a Hubbard chase with U by T equal to 4. 16 side problem is what we solved, and the PPP eigenstates. And we worked with the singlet AG plus, which is a ground state, triplet BU minus BU plus, which gives me the triplet gap. And you know that the doubly occupied site on one side and empty site on the other side are not entangled. And so it does not really add to the entanglement entropy significantly. So that's the reason why we think that PPP model is can be solved by the DMRG technique. Bhaskaran, I can go into various things, but you can tell me when you want me to stop. I will stop. Okay, but okay. Yeah, because I am not trying to finish everything that I have written out. I want to go through slowly because that's what you want. Okay. Now I will talk a little bit about our own work on the symmetrized DMRG method. And the question is, why do we need to expert symmetries?
To go back, you have a number for this entropy, Hubbard model.
Yeah.
Is it anything related to that what we know in terms of Hubbard model? Because normally we don't ask this question.
No, but I just computed the numbers and found that they were very similar. Okay? And we also, you know, this is something that we found, and then supposing we also did the icosahedral clusters, which we could solve using the, and in that case, the entanglement entropy was very large. Well, it's a three-dimensional cluster, so when you break it, then I don't know what these numbers actually mean, except saying that I have the density, the states with. States with low density matrix eigenvalues and states with high density matrix eigenvalues are the only things that are contributing. When the density matrix eigenvalue is like 10 to the minus 30, it contributes very little to entropy. When the density matrix eigenvalue is more close to 1, it also contributes very little to entropy. So it is these two extreme kinds of things that are actually having larger presence in the wave function than the ones where you have homogeneous distribution of charges problem.
And when you push this calculation to U equal to 0,
yeah.
Then you know, there is to be logarithmic the entanglement entropy familiar. We separated two systems, it goes log
here. Okay. No, we did that, we have done that for the Huggle chains only to compare. We have the results. It has appeared in JFS CONMAT. Okay. So, but
because that becomes a critical system, gapless.
Okay, gapless system, correct. Huckel model with uniform transfer integral.
So, you have research.
Yeah, so, but I have not looked at it. But we can do the calculations. Yeah, it will be a gapless system in the thermodynamic limit. Okay, so. Our main interest in density matrix renormalization group was to be able to apply it to conjugated polymers, because conjugated polymers are extremely important systems from the point of view of organic electronics. Today you see them in organic light emitting diodes, and Already they have got organic photovoltaic cells which show efficiency of about 10%, and you can have organic thin film transistors, all kinds of things that you can do, and processing is very simple, so people are interested in these materials. And for that reason we were actually looking at methods to study these things, and DMRG was probably the ideal method for studying these things. But of course, when you are looking at polymers, the important states are not just the ground state, but the lowest dipole excited state, because that is going to tell you whether a polymer is going to be fluorescent or what is the kind of intensities that you will have when the polymer starts luminescing. And you also need to know the lowest triplet state, because nowadays it's very important, particularly in the context of multi-exciton generation in the photovoltaic cells, organic photovoltaic devices. And then the lowest two photon state, because the lowest two photon state and the relative ordering of these two states, one BU state and the two AG state, is extremely important to know whether a polymer is going to be fluorescent or not. If one BU state is the lowest state, then the polymer is fluorescent. If two AG state is lower than one BU, polymer is not fluorescent. It follows from a very famous rule in organic photochemistry called the Kasha rule. And then there are also other states like MAG plus, a state with very large transition dipole to one BU state, and BU state is a large transition dipole to this MAG plus state and all that. And you cannot do an unsymmetrized thing. You know, like I said, that you can target the excited states using the DMRG, the regular DMRG. That is not useful, because depending upon the system size, the 1 BU state could be the 10th state or the 24th state or the 86th state. It is impossible to predict. It also depends upon the correlation strength. So it's...
What do you mean by unsymmetrized
methods? Unsymmetrized methods is methods where I don't use the symmetry of the polymer, which is actually the inversion center.
Oh, spatial
okay?
Symmetry.
Spatial symmetry. Or I don't use the electron hole symmetry, which is exists. Still, treat fermions as fermions. I don't use electron hole symmetry, so that my Hamiltonian is not block diagonalized. Okay? Unsymmetrized.
It's not permutation symmetry.
No, it's not permutation symmetry. It's not permutation symmetry. Permutation symmetry, no. Yeah, that is intact. That we are not playing around with. So, permutation symmetry in terms of, you know, whether the spin symmetries you are talking about.
Yeah.
Total antisymmetry. That is completely respected and honored. Okay, completely, because the matrices that you are going to write down for the creation and annihilation operators in the DMRG basis takes care of the fact that the renormalized operators are also fermionic operators. The anti-commutation relationship is there, and then when you actually use the symmetries and you switch the operators from one side to the other, then you have to do correct phase factor corrections. Depending on the number of particles in each of the density matrix eigenvectors, you will know what is the phase in order to pull the operators through. So you have to be careful. So the problem is, if I give you a Hubbard model, for example, of say 8 sites and U is equal to 2, then the lowest excited state, which is optically allowed, may be the 6th state. But if I give you 8 sites with U equal to 10, it may be the 24th side, because all the spin states will come lower in energy and the charge states will go higher in energy. So it depends upon the correlation strength. It also depends upon the chain length and so forth. So it's impossible to predict a priori what is going to be the where the 1 BU state is going to lie, whether it is a second state or the fourth state or whatever it is. So you have to use symmetry in order to get that. So the kind of symmetries that the polymers have, or when all the sites are equivalent and the system is bipartite like a polymer, then you have charge conjugation or electron hole symmetry, or it's also called the alternancy symmetry in chemistry, or it's also called the pairing symmetry or the alternancy symmetry in chemistry. Both terms are used. And what is the symmetry? At half filling, the Hamiltonian is invariant under the transformation of turning a creation operator to annihilation operator on one sublattice and replacing the creation operator by an annihilation operator with a phase minus 1 on the other sublattice. When you do this, the Hamiltonian is invariant, and this is what is called the electron hole symmetry or the charge conjugation symmetry or the alternancy symmetry or whatever, or the pairing symmetry.
And this is true only when you have a bipartite lattice.
When you have a bipartite lattice and when all the sites are equivalent. Okay, in an infinite system all the sites are equal. So what does this do? So this bipartite symmetry, when you look at spaces which are even under this symmetry or odd under this symmetry, you have the following. When under the even symmetry, the full space consists of what? You have, when you at half filling, you can have interaction energies which is 0, u, 2u, etc. Now, when you go to a space which is even under electron hole symmetry, you go to a space which consists of 0 interaction energy, states with interaction energy 0, u, 2u, etc. Under the odd, you only have interaction energies of u, 2u, etc. So when the interaction energy is 0, every site is singly occupied. When the at half filling, when all the sites are singly occupied, then you don't have any interaction energy, and that is a 0. But this is absent in the space which is odd under the electron hole symmetry. And that is why this space is called an ionic space, and this space is called the covalent space. And a dipole operator always connects these two states. And because of that, you will see that if you can get the lower state in this one and the lower state in this space, then the energy gap between these two states will be the optical gap, or the gap which is connected, or this is the states are connected by the electric dipole radiation.
But interaction mixes those two covalent and ionic space,
not mixed. No, no, interaction does not mix. No, electron hole symmetry is there whether you have interaction or no.
When
the super exchange happens like that, then you are only in the covalent space. So that is the space in which you are there is only this one, because all the states with u which are very large are thrown into the stronger excitations. Okay, charge excitations. So your spin wave excitations will only come from this space.
Covalent
subspace.
So there is actual mixing into
this. So there is a mixing of 0, u, 2u, etc. in this space, and there is also a mixing of u, 2u, etc. in this space. But the 0 won't come into this space. The covalent states won't come into this space. So that is why covalent space is the one that contains, in addition to ionic states, the covalent states. Whereas ionic space does not contain any covalent states. So that is the definition. Now, when you are looking at spin symmetries, we are always dealing with non-relativistic Hamiltonians. So the total spin is conserved, the Z component of the total spin is conserved. Exploring Z component of total spin is trivial, because all you are looking at is states which are written with spin orbitals, okay, up spin, down spin orbitals and so forth. But exploiting S squared is hard. But when MS is equal to 0, there is one more symmetry which is very interesting. So it is very much like the electron hole symmetry when you have a half filling. That is, the Hamiltonian is invariant when you rotate the all the spins by y axis by an angle pi. Okay? So which is equivalent to flipping all the spins which are up to down and down to up. So the Hamiltonian is invariant under that. And when you have that symmetry, it is easy to show that your full space consists of MS equal to 0, and MS equal to 0 consists of total spin 0, 1, 2, etc. Now, under spin inversion, even space only consists of 0, 2, 4, and the odd space consists only of total spin 1, 3, 5. So if you are targeting the singlet ground state, you are not going to have any problem with the triplet, which will be the lowest excited state. Similarly, when you are targeting the triplet, you will have no interference coming from either the quintet states or from the singlet states. So they are thrown out. Okay? So that is why this particular symmetry is also extremely useful. And these symmetries are also site symmetries. For example, if I give you the Fock space of a single site, then you have state 1 is vacuum, state 2 is upspin, state 3 is downspin, state 4 is up and downspin for a particular site. Because if you have an orbital can be empty, occupied with an upspin electron, occupied with a downspin electron, or occupied with two electrons. So that is what a Fock space is. Now the site electron hole symmetry operator JI has the property of switching the empty sites to W occupied sites and W occupied sites to empty sites, because wherever you have a creation operator, it is replaced by annihilation operator, and wherever there is an annihilation operator, it's replaced by creation operator, except that there will be a phase one has to be careful about. And you will see that 1 goes to 4 and 4 goes to minus 1, and 2 will be going to 3 eta is equal to plus 1 on the A sublattice and minus 1 on the B sublattice. Okay, 2 and 3 will be interchanging that way. So the side parity operator also has, that is a spin inversion symmetry, also has similar kind of side representation. So which is 1 going to 1, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 2, 4 goes to 4, 4 goes to minus 4. That is alpha beta goes to minus beta alpha, and alpha goes to beta, beta goes to alpha, and empty remains empty. Yeah, okay. 3:30, I can finish in about 5 to 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll just do this symmetry part and then finish. So, because they are side operators, you can represent them as direct products. And you can keep renormalizing them quite easily, you know, because just as you had side operators with spins and other things, similarly symmetry operators can also be renormalized and carried through. So that is a great advantage with this one.
I just want to point out, when physicists do this DMRG, normally they don't worry about too many excited
states. That's right. They, in fact, very rarely do they worry about excited states. For example, when they do the Kagome lattice and various things, they are not looking at the spin excitations at all.
They are focusing on that. Whereas you worry about excited states.
Because most of the, see, the idea behind using model Hamiltonians is not to worry about total energy, but to worry about the excitation spectrum. So when you come to C2 symmetry, this does not have a site representation, because C2 symmetry is left going to right and right going to left, so it's just kind of an inversion. So, but nonetheless, the C2 symmetry can be represented by this one. Mu sigma sigma prime mu prime going to mu prime sigma prime sigma mu, but then there is a phase factor, because it depends upon the number of electrons that are there in the states mu, mu prime and sigma prime. So that phase factor you can write down, and you can get a matrix representation of C2 in the base of mu sigma sigma prime mu prime, and you can also get the matrix representation of J and P in this mu sigma sigma prime basis. Okay, so it is just a direct product of all these things. So the matrix P can also be obtained. So just as you obtain the Hamiltonian matrix for the blocks, you can obtain the symmetry matrices for the blocks, and just as you obtain the Hamiltonian matrix for the entire system, you can obtain the symmetry matrices for the entire system. So once you have the symmetry matrices for the entire system, then you can do simple group theory. Okay, so you can find out how many times a particular representation is present, rather the projection operator is just given by the irreducible representation character times the symmetry. So this is just the standard projection operator, and the number of times a irreducible representation gamma occurs in the space is just this one. So you know already how many states must be there in the Hamiltonian which is symmetry adapted. And if you have an unsymmetric Hamiltonian H, then using the projection operators which are from which, because the projection operators are again square matrices, you will have to throw out all the linearly dependent rows by using either a Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization or by some other clever tricks, then you can get this operator which is a transformation operator, the symmetry transformation operator for a particular symmetry gamma. So you can get the symmetry, symmetrized Hamiltonian which is block diagonalized, and you can obtain the energies. You can compute all the properties and so forth. So for example, checks on a DMRG, this is something that we did in 96, already 16 years old. So it's very old work. So you can get from the bit answers the exact gap for U by 2 equal to 4, 1.2867, we get 1.278 from the DMRG. And for U by 2 equal to 6, we get a gap of 2.895 against 2.893 from exact result. And this is with only about a cutoff of about 150, which was the best we could do those days. And you can also show that the singlet gap for the uniform Hubbard chain has to go to 0. This is actually going to 0. And here you will see the splitting of the excitations. These are the charge excitations, these are the spin excitations. And as you increase U, the spectrum comes down because this is the number of sites on this side and the energy on this side, and you see the spectrum compresses, and in fact these things become the spin wave acceleration spectra of the Hubble model. And I think I'll stop at this point and I'll take any more questions that you may have.
See, you have been using this for a long time, but are there new entries in, or is it giving new insights?
I think there are people who are interested in it, and Garnet Chan has tried to do for molecules. But you know, the problem with doing a calculation for water molecules is like doing calculations for a DMRG calculation for a very high dimensional systems, because you will have transfer between oxygen orbital with all the hydrogen orbitals, and within the oxygen orbitals there are transfers. Okay, when you write down the Hamiltonian,
does it mean that somehow quantum entanglement, which you normally don't talk about in chemistry, is in fact playing a role?
Yeah, chemical systems are highly entangled systems usually.
So, but you know, we always thought that they stop at the level of bonding and they don't come out. But are you saying that determining
I think per se chemists are not so much worried about the entanglement aspect of the quantum states in molecules. But when you want to actually do a DMRG calculation for molecules, this is the one that actually comes in the way of doing a DMRG calculation, because the quantum chemical states, the states of molecules are highly entangled. Because when I write down a molecule, then you would see that you look at a molecular orbital going to the k-space, then you will see that there is going to be interaction between different Slater determinants, which is equivalent to saying that, which are off-diagonal, which is equivalent to saying that you have not only the nearest neighbor transfer, but you also have long-range transfer, effective long-range transfer. So once you have effective long-range transfers, then the system becomes multidimensional.
So the normal feeling that one has that if the system is gapped, is a good gap, quantum mechanics is not very important perhaps. It's not good. Is that what you are saying?
Yeah, I think chemical systems, molecules are quantum mechanical because they are very small. Okay?
But where will it show up?
The entanglement.
Yeah, property. I'm guessing like if there is a chemical reaction, you may get some unexpected results.
No, usually chemical reaction is a very, very strongly correlated system, and so probably other degrees of freedom get integrated out. See, because when the chemical reaction is happening, a bond is going to break. When the bond breaks, the transfer integral is going to zero. So U by T becomes very large. So when U by T becomes very large for that particular bond, then probably you can ignore the correlations on the other bonds. And so the system becomes basically a very strongly correlated system, which is not correlated probably, which is not entangled.
So when you meet a chemistry friend next, I'll tell him that entanglement is important.
Okay.
I don't know if this is I don't know if I should ask this question now. There's a little more technical question related to the half-filled Hubbard model. So in your notation, suppose I had a density matrix whose states were labeled by mu.
Yeah.
And I add two sites. So basically what I'm going to add is I'm going to add a system in which I have to add two more electrons.
At half filling.
At half filling.
Correct.
So that means these two sites will have four states.
Yeah.
Two doubly occupied site one and, but there is also one other state where I can take two electrons and put it in the mu states. At
correct. The restriction that you are going to place on when you are trying to find out the Hilbert space is that the total number, see, density matrix eigenvectors conserve number of electrons. Okay, so you know the number of electrons in every density matrix eigenvector. Okay, so density matrix eigenvector on the left, let us say I am dealing with a 20 side system. Density matrix eigenvector on the left has 8 electrons. Density matrix eigenvector on the right has nine electrons. Then the two sites in between must have three electrons. Otherwise, you won't have 20 electrons in 20 sites. So you put a restriction. So you always sector it by number, because number of electrons is a good quantum number. So your Hamiltonian can be sectored by total number of electrons. Correct?
I got that. Yeah. But you see, when I add these two sides,
yeah,
I'm adding two more electrons.
No. I'm only adding two sides, which means I'm adding four states on each, but not all of them will give you Hilbert space states. Say, for example, if I want three electrons, then I must have a state which is occupied by one electron on one side and two electrons on the other side, or vice versa. And I must also make sure that the m is equal to 0, which means that one side must have either up or down spin. Cannot have both up and down, is not allowed. Okay? So you put the restriction that the total ms, which is ms of the mu plus ms of the sigma side plus ms of the sigma prime plus ms of the mu prime state, is equal to 0.
Correct.
So that is for m is equal to 0 targeting. Similarly, you put the same restriction on number of electrons. Number of electrons at mu plus number of electrons in sigma plus number of electrons in sigma prime plus number of electrons in mu prime is equal to number of sides. That's at half filling.
But you see, the mu states have only particles with n minus 1 by 2 particles, right?
No. That is the Fock space. The mu sides has particles all the way from 0 to 2n minus 2. They are the Fock state space. Fock state, they are representing the Fock space. They are not representing the Hilbert space. Okay, is a many particle state with different number of particles. So every density matrix eigenvector on the left, for example, I am looking at a 20 side problem with 9 sides on the left. The 9 sides on the left, the density matrix eigenvector can have either 0 electrons or 18 electrons or any number. No, grand canonical only as far as the part is concerned. But the full system, you are going to the Hilbert space.
So before we close, so since coffee time also will have a discussion, we will come back after 20 minutes, 3:50, and then have formal discussion. And there are several questions we have not addressed, some of them. So we'll have discussion session going for about 1 hour and a half.